The reason we're here to talk about energy importantly is because energy is wealth. It's something that we care about. It gives us the things that we love, like clean water and productive industry and mobility and comfortable buildings and abundant food. And there's some surprising things about energy along the way that we should keep in mind. One is that one third of all the energy we consume as a nation goes into boiling water power plants, which I think is kind of funny. Just one third of the energy we consume just boils water to make steam, to make power at power plants. And boiling water is not even new technology. It's been around for thousands of years, and it's very important for us for these steam power plants. Then we use about half, a little less than half, of the water in the nation just to cool those steam power plants to keep them operating in an efficient way. So we end up using more water in our houses through the light switches and outlets than through the taps and shower heads because that water is cooling a power plant, but it's out of sight, out of mind, so we forget about that. So that's the connections of energy water. You'll hear a lot more about that over the coming days and through the things we've written on research on. About 13% of all the energy we use as a nation goes into heating or treating or moving or getting water and steam to the condition we like. A third of that, about 4% of national energy consumption, is just water heating, which is incredible. As a nation, we spend more energy heating water than most countries use for all purposes. We end up using more energy for our water than we use for our light bulbs. So it's kind of bizarre, sort of back and forth. We use more water through our light bulbs and switches, and we use more energy through our taps than vice versa. So that's a surprise. About 10% of our national energy consumption is embedded in the food system. This is a good news story. It gives us abundant food. It gives us food we like. But it also means we have a lot of energy there, and we also have a lot of waste, and that waste has a lot of energy embedded in it. There's more energy embedded in food waste than Switzerland uses for an entire year. So that's an opportunity. There's also a lot of agricultural waste, in particular there's manure. So here I am with a pregnant heifer about 15 years ago. And I think I've shown this before. You've seen there's a little gray box to the bottom left of that photo. That's an ammonia sensor I built. It's actually measuring the ammonia gases coming off from the manure. So it's a bullshit sensor, and I actually have a patent on it. And I got fascinated by manure. There's 100 million tons of manure every year produced by agriculture between cattle and poultry and pigs and that kind of thing. And if we turn that into biogas, we can offset 2% of our annual electricity needs, or maybe 2% of the coal that we use for that, which is incredible. And those ruminants are not only a source of the methane, or the manure we can use to make methane, they're also a source of methane directly. And we can try to capture that methane and make it a source of energy and call that fuel alternative research technology, or FARC for short, something we can look at. Those of you who know the science of ruminants, those are strongest, really the belches, so we call that biogas from unclaimed ruminant production, or BURP for short. So we've got all sorts of new technologies we're bringing to you here as we think about change. And change is one of the constants of the energy sector, one of the things we think about. We look at the way the fuels have changed over time, the different decades and eras of the United States. Wood was dominant for an era, then we entered a coal era. Now we're in an oil dominant era. But if you look at the trends, oil, well, it's actually up in 17 over 16, up in 16 over 15. But oil seems to be bumping around a little bit. Natural gas is ascendant and coal is dropping. So perhaps natural gas will overtake oil. I've been saying 1 to 2 decades for about a decade. So I think we're any year now. We'll get to the point where gas overtakes oil, which is pretty interesting. So there's constant change. And we see that change, especially with a sense of scarcity or abundance, particularly with the boom bust cycle of oil, which lives on. In Texas, the 1980s, we ran out of oil. Here's Texas Monthly saying, "So long, oil, it was fun while it lasted," right? We ran out of oil in the 80s. Then we were awash oil with oil in the 90s. Then we ran out again in the 2000s, the end of the oil age, after oil, that kind of thing. And now in the 2010s, we're awash oil again. So our mindset about scarcity and abundance flip-flops every semester, at least when it comes to petroleum. And now we're in an era of abundance. A decade ago, thought we were running out of everything, but now it seems like we have abundance. What do you do with energy abundance that changes the world? Can we start tackling energy access and energy poverty problems now? Whereas before, we had to worry about price and stability, just access to running out. So how do we take this abundance and get it to the world? At the same time, oil goes through its flip-flops. The power sector is enduring some changes, three key trends. Continuing uncertainty for carbon policy, some flat demand in the United States. These are US perspectives here. Except for a few areas of growth I'll talk about, and the rise of renewables. Carbon policy has a lot of uncertainty. President Trump pulled the United States out of the Paris Climate Accords, which I think is bad for nuclear and our national reputation, but actually won't stop the slow march to decarbonization. We're still decarbonizing because of cheap renewables and natural gas, so that will keep going on. There might be some changes to the pace, there might be some changes to some of our international negotiations, but I think the markets have spoken, and the markets are heading in that direction. In terms of electricity demand, there's a flat demand for a few areas that are bright spots for increasing electricity demand. Electric vehicles is one of them, a lot of growth there, a big opportunity for electric vehicles. These are the curves put out by Bloomberg showing growth, and you'll hear a talk later about the possibility with mobility services replacing traditional auto ownership, and that might kickstart even more adoption of electric vehicles, so we'll talk about that later. In a study that Josh Rose led, looked at electrification and transportation, and determined that would improve the economy-wide energy efficiency. And this was published in Fortune not so long ago, just in December. This is a busy chart that shows the flow of energy from the different sources on the left to the end use sectors on the right, put out by Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory. The size of the bars and the colors tells you how much energy we're using of each of those fuels. Petroleum at the bottom is the thickest bar, green. We use more petroleum than any other fuel, and it mostly goes towards transportation. There's a number at the top that says 97.3 quads. That's the total energy consumption in the United States in that year, which is 2016. There is an orange box, I know it's hard to see the fonts, for electricity generation, which is in the upper 30s. So we use like 37 quads of energy to make electricity. And then transportation is towards the bottom right. It is about 28 quads of energy for transportation. This is the traditional conventional way we use petroleum to use to get mobility with our transportation. But what happens if you electrify it? Look at those numbers as I switch to an electrified economy. And the amount of energy we need for transportation goes down because the electric drivetrain is more efficient. And then we have less energy consumption overall. Now it's 87 quads instead of 97 quads. And we have less rejected energy. So if we highly electrify transportation, which isn't going to happen overnight, might not happen to that penetration at all, it would actually achieve economy-wide gains, which I think is sort of interesting. That's the type of big picture question we like to contemplate. And of course, the utility sector would love to sell that much more electricity. So there's vested interest for people who would like to promote that. A second area of growth for electricity demand beyond electric vehicles are data centers. Information is becoming more energy intensive, and information is very popular. The growth in demand in terms of building kilowatt hours per year has been growing, but started to grow more slowly as we implemented efficiency standards at the data centers, improved the chip operation and the cooling of the systems. If we had not improved the efficiency, if efficiency was frozen at 2010 standards, the green line is where the data center consumption would have gone, except that the efficiency implementations were executed. So information is a big driver of growth for electricity demand. And a third one is pot growth, or decriminalization of recreational marijuana, which is kind of funny. We're seeing this in a place like Colorado and Washington, where marijuana growers are using electricity for their pumps and lights, and that's driving up demand. I think this is a proxy for electrified agriculture overall. Copy editors are having a lot of fun with this, writing about a budding industry. Things like profits are higher, right? The losses have gone up in smoke. There are new joint ventures. You know, so people are having a lot of fun with this. And I think this is going to be the future of agriculture. It's going to become electrified. You'll hear more about that tomorrow. We've got some sections on food. The third trend or key trend for the power sector is the rise of renewables, which is ongoing. Wind is enjoying phenomenal growth. A lot of you know that. Look at these curves. They accelerate up China, then the United States, then Germany, then India, then Spain, then Texas, number five or number six, depending on how you count. And then the UK. So a lot of growth in wind. We love wind because it's clean, but it does have its downsides, right? Especially around the holidays. So we worry about wildlife impact and other things. A lot of sad children. Solar installations are also growing. Here we have China and or Germany and Japan, United States, others, a lot of countries growing. And we don't have Texas on this one, but I think Texas will be visible on this within about a decade. Because of the rise of solar and these changes, you have to worry about the duck curve. It's on people's minds. Overgeneration during the middle of the day and the shoulder seasons where you might have negative prices or too much generation. You get this fat body in the middle from what it used to be in 2012 and what it might be in 2020. It looks a little bit like a duck if you use your imagination. So it's called the duck curve. Of course, you know, in Texas, you've heard me say this before, we call that the dead armadillo curve here. It's got the same effect where the grid stability is the roadkill from the rise of solar or something like that. Because of the concerns, Secretary Perry pushed for subsidies for coal and nuclear. He put out what's called the NOPR, the Notice of Proposed Rulemaking, which includes payments for conventional thermal power plants. And we could call this proposed payment program something like Grid Resilient Infrastructure that ensures reliable service, or GRIFTERS for short. That's an opportunity. That joke goes better in other audiences. So, Perry said nope, or FERC said nope. The Federal Energy Regulatory Commission said we're not going to do that. We want to keep the markets going and let the markets do what they want. But it does raise the question about how we think about baseload and reliable sources. The power sector can't even agree on the language of baseload. Here are six definitions of baseload. Baseload could be the lowest demand over the course of a year. It could be a paid-off plant that gives intangible value and must be seen. It could be power plants that ramp slowly. It could be just a proxy for coal and nuclear. Or maybe a resource with the lowest levelized long-run marginal cost, or maybe a resource with the least-run short-time marginal dispatch cost. But there's another half dozen or so definitions for baseload. I was at a meeting this summer with a lot of executives from the utility industry. For a day and a half, we argued over the word baseload and then concluded that it's now an obsolete term and possibly even damaging. Baseload reveals a different kind of mindset about how the sector should operate. And I suggest to you as an action item that we should switch to a supply-following mindset rather than a load-following mindset. Let me explain what that means. Right now, we have our loads are changing. We're turning on light bulbs or operating different things. The load goes up and down with our use and with the weather. And then we ramp the power plants up and down to follow our load. That's the way we've always done it. Well, now we have supply like wind and solar that comes and goes whether we want it or not. And so we have variability in our supply. Perhaps we should ramp our load up and down to match when the supply is available, which means we need to come up with a lot of flexible industrial processes. Things like running data centers or treating water or making electrofuels, you'll hear about these things later, that you can do in a flexible way, ramp up and down to match when the supply is available. So now industrial manufacturers will be able to get cheap electricity and be paid to prop up the grid and be able to make higher value goods that are worth more than the electricity. So that's the mindset we need to get to. Another solution we could keep in mind is to solve our waste problem. We have a massive waste problem. And I like to say that waste is what you have when you run out of imagination. That there's an opportunity to use this waste as a set of a costly environmental liability turned into a valuable commodity. In the future, there'll be no difference in waste and energy, says HSBC. Wrote an article on this. There are copies out in the front, so feel free to grab one for Scientific American about the future of smart cities are those cities that tap into their trash or all their waste streams, waste heat, wasted time, wasted space, municipal solid waste, you name it, to get energy out of it. And there's a saying that one man's trash, another man's treasure. Well, that's true in Switzerland. There's $2 million a year of gold in the sewage just from the different metals refining other things that get washed out in little flecks. I imagine the number's even higher in the United States because we're a bigger country. So if we can find a way to harness out the valuable bits of the waste, either to make energy or reduce environmental impact or just to get a lot of gold, that would be good for us. And the way to, it's a hard way to get gold, but I guess gold's hard to get. That's why it's expensive. Another way to think about reducing waste is to use more data and make our system smarter, better metering, better flows of energy, better flows of information, track our energy. We have a system that's very leaky. About 1% of our natural gas is lost through leaks. About 10 to 40% of our treated water is lost or leaked from where it leaves the water treatment plant to the meter in our cities. Austin's on the better end of that spectrum, but some cities have a very leaky system. And electricity, as you saw in those charts a little earlier, more than half the energy we consume goes out as rejected energy as waste heat. So we have these waste streams that are available for us to harness if we just have more information to better optimize systems. And that data flow that goes with it actually has a value to it. In fact, people say that that's the world's most valuable resource, that that is the new oil. That oil used to be the thing that made us rich, but maybe data will be what makes us rich in the future. And certainly the economists has claimed that. And to some degree, you can see that's happening just in terms of market capitalizations. If you look at the top 10 market capitalizations in the public exchanges, it's Apple, then Google, then Microsoft, then Amazon, then Facebook. Top five are data companies or IT companies. Then you get to Berkshire Hathaway, which owns data and energy. Then you get to ExxonMobil. Number seven is the first energy company. It used to be energy companies were at the top of the list. They're moving down, getting replaced by data. And by the way, there's more data companies at the end there. The rise of big data and the value that comes with it enables the rise of artificial intelligence. We can use smarter approaches to the way we operate things to achieve efficiencies. This is happening in oil and gas right now. It used to be you have 12 guys on a site for production. Now you might have two and some smarter algorithms. So it takes fewer people to achieve the same kind of production, which means we're replacing men with machines. That's a 150-year-old tradition that's happened in the Industrial Revolution as well. So this march of the machines and the rise of data enabling the replacement of ourselves means that dangerous jobs can be done by machines and we'll do other things. Maybe we'll move into more creative economy or something else. The data become important for our infrastructure as well because our infrastructure represents significant costs. This is just the power sector. This is a study that Josh Rhodes published. If we had to replace the power sector tonight, which we won't, but if we had to, it would cost about $5 trillion. So that's for the wires and poles and the power plants, the transformers and substations and that kind of thing. Its depreciated value is about $2 trillion. It's worth trillions of dollars. Infrastructure. And by the way, the natural gas infrastructure is like $8 trillion. Most of that's in the distribution lines at the final mile. The oil infrastructure is probably even higher, maybe $10 trillion. We're not done with those numbers. So this is many trillions or tens of trillions of dollars in our infrastructure. But we have a problem that it's possible to have infrastructure that's built for the wrong purpose or in the wrong place, in the wrong time, point in the wrong direction. I like to call this the Maginot Line of energy. If you've studied World War II, you know about the Maginot Line. This is a fortified boundary between France and Germany. The French, tired of the Germans invading them all the time, said, okay, we're going to build a fortified wall hundreds of kilometers long that's going to point towards Germany with our guns pointed at you to keep you from invading us. They built a very expensive, extensive infrastructure in the wrong place, pointed the wrong direction, because Germany just went around through the Ardennes Forest and Belgium and came around, and then the French couldn't turn the guns around because they were locked into place pointed the wrong way. They got a false sense of security from this, and we do the same thing with our energy infrastructure, where we spend a lot of money to build energy infrastructure at just the wrong time or in the wrong place pointed the wrong direction. We built a bunch of oil-fired power plants in the 60s, early 70s, just in time for the oil crisis, and then had to switch them to coal or natural gas or something else. We built a bunch of LNG, liquefied natural gas, import terminals, just in time to need export terminals. And now I wonder if we're going to build a south going pipeline to bring oil from Canada, when we should bring a north going pipeline from Mexico instead, or if we should build central, we just built centralized water systems, one in Austin, hundreds of millions of dollars for that. Maybe we should have built distributed systems. And now in Austin, we're talking about building expanded highways with double deckers on moped and that kind of thing, when maybe we should enable connected autonomous vehicles or something else. So I wonder about that. Is possible with the delays it takes to get your infrastructure built to build the wrong thing? And maybe smarts and big data can help us avoid those mistakes by extending the life of our current systems. If we need a trillion or two for our water, wastewater systems, if we need a trillion or two for our power sector, and we're not in the mood to spend trillions, looks to me like we're not in the mood as a nation to spend trillions of dollars, then we could use Internet of Things and data to extend the existing infrastructure's life for a little bit longer for less than $1 trillion. And in fact, there's an opportunity there. We're just managing water more intelligently, more smartly. I don't know if more smartly is a word. Smarter. And that's worth $12 billion a year by 2021. Cities will have intelligence there that's worth $1 trillion by 2025. And just reducing losses of water electricity is worth $70 billion a year. So that's incredible, right? There's an economic opportunity here with data and metering and open platforms to get real economic value. So those are some changes. And along we have these changes in possibility of data, and we also have big events. Hurricane Harvey was one of those big events. It was momentous. It is incredible. This was a flood event more than a wind event. It was unlike anything we've seen in memory. It dumped 34 trillion gallons of water in the Houston area. It just parked there. I know many of you in this room were affected. A lot of friends who had houses that were destroyed or had to get rescued by boat or that kind of thing. So this is really dramatic and really incredible. But that water is worth money. It's a little bit like asking God to give you some money from the sky, and then God said, sure, here it goes. And if you put a price on it, it's a lot of money. Water is worth something like $4 per thousand gallons, which means that Harvey dumped about $136 billion worth of water from the sky, and it did about $136 billion in damage. So perhaps Mother Nature knows irony, which I think is kind of funny. There's some sarcasm or something there, which you gotta keep in mind. It's like, hey, please give me some money, and you think, you're like, okay, I'm gonna give you gold, but you have to catch it. You're trying not to get better. That flood had a huge impact on the energy sector. The fuel sector was hit hard. About 25% of national refining capacity was shut in for a little bit. Crude production was mostly unaffected. This is bizarre. Usually when we have a hurricane, crude is disrupted, crude prices spike because the offshore platforms are turned off and that kind of thing. But the production on shore was not turned off. The refineries were, and that caused crude prices to drop because there was a glut. So this was different than typical hurricane effects. It did affect our food systems. This is at my neighborhood McDonald's. I came up to order food. If you zoom in on the sign, I took this picture of my iPhone. Due to dear valued guest, by the way, so I was a valued guest. Due to Hurricane Harvey, we're temporarily out of certain products. Our distribution center is located in Houston. They are doing their very best to replenish our stock. Sorry for the inconvenience. I mean, my food in Austin is disrupted by Harvey in Houston. This is where the crisis really happens. Zero. There's only so much we can take, right?
McDonald's no less.
Yeah, it's McDonald's no less. I know. I really don't go to McDonald's that often, I promise. But they got breakfast around the clock now, right? So it's different. I was shopping for a friend. Hurricane Harvey also might be the impetus we need to rethink our relationship with cars, because it was the single largest incident of automobile destruction in human history. Half a million cars, some people say maybe as many as 1 million vehicles, including the trucks and fleets at the different installations, were killed. This is one of the three salvage yards to store the damaged cars. There's another one in Columbus, Texas. These are pictures that Jeff Phillips here took. And he took this video as well as he flew his drone. Oh, I'm gonna go back. As he flew his drone over that. This just goes on and on. Well, no, maybe the video's not gonna work. But it just goes on and on, thousands and thousands and thousands of cars. And you'll see some spots where cars were, they've already moved them out. The cars don't look damaged, they were flooded. They weren't dented. They were just ruined on the inside. So that's an incredible opportunity for auto manufacturers to make something new. It's also an opportunity for us to rethink auto ownership. You're gonna hear about that later today. Maybe we should replace all 500,000 cars with 500,000 cars. Maybe you should replace them with 400,000 cars and a lot of micro transit or point-to-point transit or mobility services or something like that. And so I think that ties in with other trends, which is that car ownership and usage models will get disrupted with new opportunities. Autonomous vehicles on the right or mobility services on the left, and there's some real value in that. And if we harness that value, which you'll hear about later today, it will change urban structures and routines. I think the insurance industry will drive the shift to mobility services and autonomous vehicles, because they figured out that a robot is safer than a teen with a phone that can text. So that's a big part. Also, the robots don't tend to get drunk at night before they drive home. They don't get distracted. So there's a lot of things, a lot of benefits there. And then also free up some space in cities. By some studies, the parking consumes a lot of space and time, but also 30% of the cars at peak congestion times in some cities are people looking for a place to park. What if you didn't have to have all those people looking for a place to park because they could be dropped off point to point? You could free up some lanes used for parking that means more flow of people, and then you could also remove parking structure to get denser living, just have cars in circulation. So I think that's really interesting. In places like England, motorists, I like how they call them motorists, that sounds fancier than drivers or, you know, angry rage drivers or something. They spend 4 days a year looking for a parking space. I believe it. If you've been to England, that makes a lot of sense. And they have plenty of tiny cars, they still can't find a place to park. So these are some real challenges, there's some trends afoot, and managing all those challenges and trends is, I think, the key challenge for the 21st century, the good and the bad inequities of energy. And to do that, we need to have trade-offs foremost in our minds. We also have to have deep understanding of energy fundamentals, and we have to have fluency in the language of energy, which motivates us to ramp up on our education. We have to take education on energy very importantly. But students learn differently than my generation as a teacher, so I have to think about how I should teach. And there are a couple of guiding principles. One is there are two types of people in the world. One are those who can extrapolate from incomplete data. I never did forgot the rest of that one. And then another way to think about it is there are 10 types of people in the world, those who understand binary and those who don't. So it's all mysterious to me. But it's something to me that energy environmental education, it'll make sense in just a second, just give it some time. Energy environmental education is ripe for innovation. I've written about that, some of what we tackle. And I think energy and environmental literacy go hand in hand with STEM education. And that's part of it. We do need more STEM, but we also need critical thinking, which you get in the liberal arts and humanities. You don't get that in engineering. Engineering gives you analytical thinking. We also need creative thinking, which you get in music or fine arts, other places. And that is a sign to me that STEM education needs to evolve to STEAM education, because the earth without art is just, you probably heard that before. So we need to be visual. And that, I think the solution that's provided by that is to make interactive teaching tools, use modern tools for digital natives. We've got a couple projects underway I want to tell you about. A series of television efforts. We talked about energy, the movies in the past. That was something we made here at UT. It was syndicated nationally from 2013 to 2015. I was telling the story of energy using movie clips to tell the story, which is a lot of fun. And that got some traction. So now we're doing some other efforts. One is to take the book Thirst for Power, which there are copies out front if you guys want some, and I think some of you already have a copy, turning that into a 1-hour documentary this year for fall 2018 with support from Itron. And hoping to get that on PBS or Netflix or somewhere like that. And also working on a 6-part series, Power Trip, The Story of Energy. The 6 parts are water, food, wealth, cities, transportation, and security. The goal is to get that on the up in the air in the first quarter or second quarter of 2019. PBS is already committed to nationally distribute that one. And United Airlines said they would include it in their in-flight entertainment and will be on Scientific American's website. So that series should reach millions, if not tens of millions of people. So there's several television initiatives underway, which is kind of fun. And we also have been dabbling in the area of course apps, these applications you can download that have reference materials or teaching materials. Energy 101 has been out for several years. That's really good fit for high school and colleges. A lot of colleges already adopted about a dozen universities, including Stanford and Duke and Calgary and other places have used Energy 101 as a reference. We use it here at UT. And I've got support from CECO, the State Energy Conservation Office, to make some of the teacher's guides so high schools can use it more easily. We have an app called Resourcefulness based on the book, Thirst for Power, Energy, Water, and Human Survival. That's more of 6th to 10th grade. We got support from Itron to make that available to different schools. And then we're also working on a companion series to the TV show for 6th to 8th grade students, and working on something called Watt Watchers. If some of you in education in Texas will know that this was around about 15 years ago, a sponsorship from CECO to teach kids at K-5 about energy. We are resuscitating that right now with their sponsorship to get something interactive where kids can get involved, keeping track of the resource use in their schoolrooms and turning off the lights, turning off the faucets, reducing their waste, that kind of thing, getting them interactively engaged in this. So we're making a lot of course apps and getting deeper into the educational space as we go. Energy 101 is the first one we dabble with. This is designed around the class I teach, a graduate multidisciplinary class, and is assigned as a reference material for that. Starts with the fundamentals of energy, then goes through the different types of fuels, then goes through the cross-cutting things like energy, water, and food. And then Resourcefulness is another app we made, focus on the book, looking at energy, water, 8 sections, energy, water, water for energy, energy for water, that kind of thing. And the partnership with Disco Learning Media, you'll hear more about it in just a minute, produces that, distributes it, and Itron makes it available for free to the school. So we see corporate sponsorship as an important part of filling the educational materials gap as public funding declines. So those are some of the things we're doing from an educational perspective. Be happy to talk with any of you about that offline if you are interested. And we have these materials. If you know schools that need them, let us know. As we tackle the problems, we're going to need new types of problem solvers. This is the research side of us. We need modern engineers who are global and have policy savvy and are engaged with the public and are skilled communicators and have an analytical ability combined with critical thinking. I think modern policymakers will also be different because they're dealing with more and more technical problems like healthcare or cybersecurity. These are all technical in nature, and engaging with engineers would be good for the policymaking process, especially if those engineers can speak policy language and are available to meet with them. So that's our group. That's what we're trying to do. Let me introduce the group. The objective of our group is, well, twofold. We have a vision, a mission, and two objectives we seek to achieve that way. The vision is that the world will see us as engaging an expert group of people who can effectively communicate non-biased, objective, dispassionate information about energy and the environment. We want to be an authoritative source of information for people grappling with energy issues. And the mission is to change the way the world thinks about energy. We think there's a lot of new thinking we can do, and it's not just getting new fact and finding, but telling them about it. So the objective, the two parts we have to achieve this mission, is to perform rigorous, multidisciplinary research that stands the test of time on topics related to energy and the environment. It starts with good research. We have to have good fact and finding. And then second, we disseminate. We take our findings as broadly as possible with a particular focus on educating the general public and informing policymakers. I am very critical of the traditional academic establishment that comes up with incredible innovations and then doesn't bother to tell anybody and leaves it on the shelf. In our opinion, if it doesn't make it into new policies or new markets, then it really hasn't achieved its goals. It needs to come up with new products and services or new legislation or regulatory standards or something to really be effective. So that's our two-part goal. We have a very outward-facing, intentional, proactive communications goal. The group is vibrant. There are 17 graduate students, almost exclusively PhD students, 8 undergrads, 5 professionals, 3 postdocs sitting around the room, you'll meet them all, 1 administrative professional and a multimedia professional, and over 3 dozen alumni. Here are our research professionals, our postdocs, our research fellows, Dr. Todd Davidson on the left, Josh Rhodes in the middle, and Charlie Upshaw on the right. And there are sort of casual photos. This is what they look like. Actually, Charlie's wearing that exact same shirt right now as in the photo.
I have multiple shirts.
Yeah, he is. You'll hear, he has like 8 of those shirts. So that's really funny. I should have guessed that that's what he'd be wearing. And then 2 professional staff, Sarah DeBerry-Caperton, you met out front, who helped us organize all this, and Jeff Phillips here, who's doing the multimedia and helps us communicate more visually. We have 8 undergraduate interns or researchers, names listed there, you'll see some of them present. We have 17 graduate students shown here. I'm proud to say that 7 of the 17 are female. That's something we take seriously, and that's something that UT takes seriously, is working on diversity in our research and our education. Because of the topics we care about, I think it draws from people who have a service ethic and care about the future, and I think a lot of females are drawn to that along with the men. These photos are interesting. There's actually little clues in there that tell you about that person. This is supposed to be selfies in their natural setting. Scott Vitter, 2nd from the right at the top, is the only one that took it seriously. He's eating an apple or something when he took the photo, which I think is pretty authentic. Carlos Galliano, 3rd from the left on the top. You can't see, but there's a changing table behind him because he has a brand new baby, so that's true. And then Philip White, who I'll show here. He looks kind of wide-eyed. That's because he was studying for quals right when we took that photo. So he's got tired quals. He passed his quals along well, so we're happy about that. But, so a natural setting. Oh, here's Philip right here. These PhD students are passionate. They are foregoing current income in order to forego future income. I think that's really it says a lot about them. The students are laughing, if you notice that. the trade-offs of life, yeah. We have a range of academic disciplines, primarily engineering, mostly mechanical engineering and civil engineering, but also chemical engineering, petroleum engineering, electrical engineering. We have physics students. We have some dual degree students, students who pursue degrees in public affairs and engineering, or plan to. It's a liberal arts program as undergrads. So we have a multidisciplinary approach. We're engineering heavy, but we like to include these other topics and ways of thinking where we can. I'm proud to say that recent PhD graduates have found jobs. None of them are unemployed, and if they can't find a job, usually I hire them as a postdoc. They could have had other jobs, but they're here. We're happy about that. Several of them are faculty. Our most recent ones joined the faculty at the U.S. Military Academy. Dr. Corey James, or Lieutenant Colonel James, came here, sent by the Army to get his PhD to go back and be an academy professor. And Bonnie Roberts at the University of South Florida is a senior lecturer there, teaching 3 classes a semester. So we have several in the world of academia, national labs, industry, and different places, several entrepreneurs as well. Preparing PhD students for a possible life in academia is part of the job. That includes fashion tips. We talk about how you should dress. Thankfully, The Gap helped us out because they launched the tenure track professor blazers. I'm not kidding. This is real. Get respect for your ideas and your blazer choices. So this is look it up. This is not a joke. This is real. Of course, I suggest they should also come up with the adjunct professor gear, which is, you know, we'll teach with food, sign comes with it, and it's made out of crushed dreams, the fabric. And then the tenured professor, for people like me, it's a, you know, flexible material so you can reach your cane, that kind of thing. Those are new lines that the Gap has not picked up yet, but we recommend. We also have to release our PhD students into the wild when they're done, especially if they go to academia. There are senior faculty waiting. We actually have a documentary of a new PhD student going into academia being released in the wild. Here's the video. It's a documentary. Here's the PhD student about to be released. It's very fragile, very delicate.
It's too windy.
Yeah, there's hope and joy in the voice, right? You hear that? Why? You can do it.
Great go.
Yeah, you got to get out of graduate, right? So that's where we're saying, get out of here.
You can do it.
No, she's videoing the butterfly.
Yeah.
Letting it free.
You can do it free. Oh, you're free. And senior faculty are waiting for you to welcome you to your new job and as a professor. And here we are.
Oh.
Yeah.
He's coming back for you.
Yeah. Brutal world out there. The alumni have made it. None have been eaten in midair so far. We do have alumni worldwide. A map around the world. We've got a student in Saudi Arabia, a former student that was in Israel for a while, England, Japan, Scotland. We have one in Oklahoma. So we're getting a whole all of the countries covered. I'll talk about the Oklahoma in a minute. The group's objectives are fulfilled with 5 strategic priorities. It all starts with rigorous research, but then the goal is to educate people, do a lot of outreach, do policy engagement, and also do commercialization. And I'll talk about commercialization a little bit more than normally because there's a couple new developments. But entrepreneurship and commercialization is a growing part of what we do. And that hammering, by the way, they're building a whole new building, so I need the back row, you especially get that. My apologies for that. One of the things we do is teach a class called Entrepreneurship. This is through the incubator, Austin Technology Incubator and IC Squared. It's a freshman class. It first started in 2015. It has experiential learning where the students actually go through a process called 3-day startup where they're locked into a place for like 3 days to form teams. There's like 20 students. They form 4 or 5 teams. And then they launch a company by the end of the weekend and they spend all semester creating business plans and launching that company. And it's a lot of fun. A former TA, Coleman Tharp, was in the group as an undergrad, actually launched a company I'll talk about again in a minute. And then Isabella Gee, back here, was a TA this time. And one of the students from the semester, Hannah Fossett, up here, we hired her as our social media intern to help us communicate well to the world. So that class is a way to identify really smart students and launch successful companies out of it. We do, as a group, have a successful partnership with the Austin Technology Incubator in a variety of ways. I help run the Clean Energy Incubator with Richard Amato. I know where Richard is. Here's Richard over here. And others, and Charlie Upshaw, you'll hear from tomorrow, runs Water Riot, which is a water resiliency through Internet of Things. We like acronyms around here. So you'll hear more about that. We also try to file disclosures for inventions as often as possible through the Office of Technology Commercialization and file with the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office. We also launched companies, so several different companies I want to mention. One is IdeaSmiths, Disco Learning Media, Resilient Grid, East Texas Integrated Land Management, which we opened and failed, and we kind of opened again, it might have already failed already, so I'm not going to spend much time on that one. And then Low Carbon Beef. Maybe we'll talk about East Texas Integrated Land Management in future years. We'll see. I'll look at the guy here in the room. IdeaSmiths was launched by Josh and Charlie. He spun out of UT in 2013 to do parallel work on due diligence and vetting. There's a lot of vetting of technologies that need to happen in the private sector that are hard to do through a university setting. So we set up a consulting company to do that. And we analyze energy and water systems and actually have several Fortune 100 company clients, which is very interesting. There's a need to vet inventors' claims. And so that's one of the things that these guys can do. Michael Leggett was in the group. He got a PhD in electrical engineering after getting his PhD in behavioral psychology. I mean, who doesn't have 2 PhDs, right? And he was one of 2 behavioral psychologists in the power sector nationally. He spun out a company called Resilient Grid in 2016 with the goal of supporting control room operators as the grid's complexity continues to grow. One thing he's seen in his eyes is that when things get tough in the control room, sometimes human error makes the problems worse. And so if we could visualize or understand the data better, that might be an opportunity. So he's trying to work with grid operators and different companies to improve the way they visualize different overlapping layers of infrastructure. That could also apply for cybersecurity or healthcare and other things. And 1 or 2 of his board members are in the room right now, which is a lot of fun. I also mentioned our Oklahoman, that's Dr. Colin Beal, got his PhD here in mechanical engineering. He set the record for the speed it takes to get a PhD. He did it in 2.5 years, which is pretty darn fast, a record for the Weber Group. He did life cycle analysis of algae, making proteins and food and feed and fresh water and fiber from biomaterials. He was a varsity baseball player before he came to UT at Virginia Tech, got his PhD here, so he's multi-talented. Has his own consulting company, B&D Engineering, with Todd Davidson here, and has done a variety of projects for a lot of people, including NASA. But now he's got a herd of cattle, so he decided he didn't want to be an engineer, he wanted to be a rancher. He's got a bunch of head of cattle in Oklahoma, and he's developing systems for low-carbon beef, which is really interesting, because if you tackle the genomics the right way, you can improve the productivity, reduce the burping, reduce the methane, and reduce the inputs to get the same amount of food. And that becomes important because agriculture is a big part of the global greenhouse gas balance. So he's doing that. His father was a professor of agriculture for 40 years at Virginia Tech, so it's in the family. He's been around cattle his entire life. So he's launching a couple initiatives. And I also want to mention Disco Learning Media, spun out of UT in 2015 with Juan Garcia and Coleman Tharp. I don't think they're in the room, but you might have met them before if you've been here a couple years ago because they were here presenting as well. This was spun out of that class on entrepreneurship. While Coleman was an undergrad, he was a TA. So he's sort of a whiz kid in that he was an undergrad and a TA for this entrepreneurship class, creating a company that creates interactive educational materials. It's funded out of UT and it grew every year, so we just sold it. It just got acquired a couple days ago, actually, to Probility Media Corporation. And Paul Bunch, who's in the room somewhere, was our investment banker, helped make that deal happen. So thanks, Paul, for that. So we got a successful exit. We got a few other companies that haven't died yet and one exit through acquisition, which is kind of exciting. So that's one thing you'll see us talk more about in the coming years, is this commercial side of life. We also engage with policymakers. That's one of our main priorities. So we seek to bridge the divide between policymakers and engineers. It's our belief that bad policy holds up good engineering and that there's a big divide between policy and the scientific world. So our job is to speak the language and bridge that actively. We can't wait for policymakers to learn engineering. We have to learn policy and come to them. And to do that, we can't be ideological or partisan or agenda-driven. We cannot be advocates. If we testify, we have to sign up as a resource. We do not sign up to be for or against any particular legislation, but we can be passionate, fact-driven, engaged, and very educational and informative. That's our intent. And we engage with policymakers in a variety of ways. We do through testimony. I or students or postdocs in the group have testified a couple dozen times in total, including briefings for staffers. We write research roadmaps for the Department of Energy or National Science Foundation, a variety of reports. The U.S. Department of Energy report on grid resilience that came out a few months ago actually cited some of our work, which is nice that we were able to engage with them on that. And also the students participate in internships that puts them into the policy process at the White House. I think we had 5 students at the White House, some at Energy Information Administration, the Texas Legislature, Congressional Research Service, think tanks or nonprofits that serve D.C. thinkers, that kind of thing. And then we also have this Archer Fellowship Program at UT that several students have taken advantage of, where you, through UT, go on an internship to DC and take classes in DC as a part of UT. So we engage in a variety of ways. We also try to build personal relationships. This is former student David Wogan jogging with Rick Perry when he was governor in 2008 with a fuzzy picture, but David's wearing the Weber Energy Group t-shirt at the time, so he's doing the hook'em while Perry does the gig'em. And then he just hosted Secretary Perry in Saudi Arabia in 2017, so this is David 9 years later, looks more professional now and less sweaty, with Rick Perry, who looks about the same, but does better. And here's David Wogan also in front of the White House a couple times in 2010. Here's Joel Shelson with Secretary of Energy Moniz. We hosted him at UT a couple different times for a roundtable discussion in 16 and then some public speeches and events in 2014. So we try to be available for the staffs and the electeds and then engage personally wherever we can. For our research, which is at the core of what we do, none of this happens without rigorous research. We have to be really attached to the facts and truth. We have 4 main topical thrusts. We look at advanced transportation fuels, which you'll hear a little bit about with mobility services later today. We look at food systems with a particular emphasis on waste, you'll hear about tomorrow. The next is energy and water, we talked a lot about over the years, you'll hear about tomorrow. And dynamic modeling large-scale energy systems, which is like the smart grid, but also the bulk grid. We do a lot of bulk grid modeling. And I just want to say that grid modeling is dangerous. This is a sign that you might see. Danger, not only will this kill you, it will hurt the whole time you're dying, which I think is kind of that's one way to get people's attention. Electricity is dangerous. But grad students are willing to suffer to get their PhD done, so that's what I say sometimes. We've also done some food analysis. Here's some published research that shows the propensity you are to eat food out of a bowl. When you're young, you eat out of a bowl. As you get older, you don't. But as you get really old, you eat out of a bowl. Again, there's this blip with grad school, you eat food out of a bowl a lot. And we have not confirmed this 100%, but our informal field try suggests this is true with a sample of 20 plus current and former students. So bowls are very important for food early on. And so here's a picture actually of one of our students in action right now. The group's mission is supported by a variety of organizations of people. That's you, and really appreciate your support. Your research contracts for this give us credibility and stability in a task-oriented mission. And then a lot of you give us discretionary support, which we can use to get ahead of the curve and for flexibility and creativity with our work. We really appreciate your support. We're primarily funded through foundations and nonprofit organizations. followed by state government, federal government, industry, local government, and individual gifts. Over the last 9-year period, well, I guess it's really a 10-year period, brought in about $12.5 million. We have about $1 million a year program to fund the 30 people I mentioned earlier. So it's a big program. We're able to keep costs lower through fellowships because the students often win these fellowships and these other awards, and that support makes all the difference for us. We couldn't do it without you. This diversity of support is very important because sometimes the government's in the mood to support R&D, sometimes it's not. Sometimes industry has the money to support R&D, sometimes it doesn't, and they're often out of phase with each other. So if we have the right kind of diversity to our support, then we can keep our projects going and move the world forward regardless of what's happening in the broader economic context. This is a small font, not just to read it, but here are all the different sponsors. We thank you very much. I hope your name is on there. And if your name's supposed to be on there, it's not, let me know and I'll be sure to add it. We missed one or two names in the program, which also lists our sponsors. We really appreciate it. We really thank you for that. Your discretionary support in particular allows us to invest in the leadership development of students. This is a differentiator for us. We do good research, but then we want to make leaders who will make good decisions later on. Last year, we were honored by the establishment of endowment to fund student leadership development. Many thanks to the Osborne and Green family for this. And they're here, actually, Cece and Robin Moore. Thank you for that. This is a picture of them a couple years ago with Rusty at the top. I got his degree from UT in Botany in 1975. Rusty's no longer with us. And Cece got a degree in 1979. Lauren, just like, I guess last year, got your degree, right? So your master's from community regional planning. And then Robin got his undergrad degree in engineering. So they're all connected to UT. And they're all dedicated to clean energy and sustainability. And when Rusty passed, they set up an endowment, partly in his name. It's the Osborne Green Energy Endowed Excellence Fund, which is a play on words because Cecilia's last name is Green, and they support green energy. It's actually the first green energy endowment at UT Austin that I could find. And what's fun to see is always sort of tragic when anyone dies, but it's fun to see that the support for that endowment has grown 30% in the last year and a half or so, which is Rusty's memory lives on. He's still with us, so we still miss him very much. So it keeps growing, and that supports our leadership development efforts today with the students. So I thank you for that, and really hats off to you for doing that. Thank you. Now, leadership. This is the part where I choke. It's always sad to talk about Rusty, but we miss him, and he lives on with us, so we appreciate him being here. There'll be a dinner tonight also if you want to meet them and hear more about Rusty. That leadership development is comprised of many things. We focus on communications, good speaking and good writing. We focus on things like goal setting and exploring the role of the engineer in society and how do we run a meeting and networking, all these soft skills that you don't learn through analytical approaches in engineering but are critical to success in the broader world. And this kind of support from that endowment elsewhere lets us bring in people who can teach us these things. In particular, we like to focus on communicating well. And good communication means sharing information in the proper sequence. Here's one example. If you read it first on the left and then the right, it would be an encouraging message that says, you matter, don't give up. If you read it like a normal person reads the top line and the bottom line, it's jaded advice from a professor, which is, you don't matter, give up. If it were a black hole, it would be, you don't give up matter, right? So there's all sorts of ways to think about this. And if you like the anagram, which is you're an unmotivated guy or pet, which is kind of funny. So the same words in different sequences has very different meanings. You can even take the words, phrase, I love you, and if you have an exclamation point versus a question mark versus a period, it has different meanings. So communicating well is something we think about, and we bring in outside experts with the support to do that. We work with people like the Coro Institute, Steve Redfield there, Russell Fluff, who brought up Stanford University, Johnny Johnson, Karen Turquist from Executive Coaching, world-class coaches. I don't see Karen here, but she's come here before. And they help us on all these different skills we need. And I think that's an important part of making complete engineers, engineers that are more useful to society. Along the way, we try to have a group spirit and a fun camaraderie. We look to the sky together to set our goals. Here we are at the SWET lab, the Solar Water Energy and Thermal Lab at the roof of our McKinley Engineering Building, looking up at the solar eclipse, which you're not supposed to do, but we all had our appropriate gear to look at that. Then we took a picture looking at the camera. Except for Scott Bitter in the upper right. So he's, I don't know what happened, Scott, but he's just ready to go to the next level. And then we also have other eclipses that happen. Here's a classic one in the PhD world where it's an eclipse, which really your professor comes and say, hey, get back to work. Lunar eclipse and the electrical eclipse. The group's members have earned many awards and accomplishments along the way. They've been very successful. They've been prolific with their authorship. They write a lot of things. The core product that we try to generate are papers that people will read that will lead to products and companies and policies. We've published over 80 peer-reviewed conference papers and over 90 scientific papers. Those are 170 total plus over the last 8 years or so. And these papers are read. People download them by the thousands and tens of thousands, which are pretty high for a scientific paper. That's not typical. I think that's a big part of this. We couldn't do it without you. You're key to this, and that's why we have the symposium, which is to thank you. So walk through the objectives of the symposium. This symposium gives our students a chance to, and the staff, a chance to practice communicating the work to an intelligent audience with mixed expertise. That's you. You're all very intelligent, well-educated, but you might hear things that you're not an expert in. And so you're a good test for us on how to communicate this. But you are also experts on some of the things we present, so your feedback will be very important for us on either how to communicate better, how to do the research better. You also might have expertise or data that we need to get our work done. So we're hoping you will help us make progress on all of this. It's also a chance for you, our friends and family, sponsors and affiliates, to receive a survey of interesting research, just to get an update on what we do, to get a sneak peek at our work before it's public, to advise our methodologies before we go off the rails and do something stupid. So if we're on the wrong track, let us know. That's important for us. And you can also provide suggestions, insights, and expertise, and maybe you can recruit these students and postdocs to your teams. This is a good pipeline in town for you. That's happened here before, and I expect you might see some talks or people that might be a good fit for your company. One of the main objectives for the symposium is to express our gratitude for your support and to celebrate a successful year. We do it in January to look back. You're saying it's a good year, and thank you, because we couldn't have done it without you. And so we have an agenda to convey these messages. Today is presentations through lunch, then we'll have lunch for a little over an hour, then we'll have presentations with break, and then we'll do a group photo for just the students and staff and me, and then we'll meet at El Mercado for drinks and dinner. El Mercado's a block that way. So we'll meet for dinner there, then start up again tomorrow. Tomorrow's 8:30 a.m., not 10 a.m. And then we'll go to about 3:30 p.m., more presentations. So we want you here the whole time, yeah, as much as you can make. I realize somebody had to step out for phone calls and that kind of thing. You do what you need, that's fine, but we, of course, you're welcome for the whole 2 days. Here's what we want from you, is we want you to ask questions. Every student's got a presentation. They do have a few minutes set aside at the end. They shouldn't take up the whole time to answer your questions. We hope you'll have questions. We expect you to have questions. Share whatever data insights you can. Give feedback. You should also feel free to clap when the presentation is done. Sometimes in scientific or engineering presentations, it's not obvious, but clapping is appropriate, and we'd like that very much. And also introduce yourself to the students, the staff, and the team. We'll have breaks, we'll have meals. Sit with us, talk with us. Find someone that you like their work and talk to them about it. We really want that engagement. If at lunch I find all my students are seated at one table and everyone else at a different table, that would be a failure in my opinion. We're hoping to really mix and match so we can all get to know each other. And I'll stop there. I really just want to say thank you very much.